this morning, before we jump in, we're going to be in John chapter 14. So if you want to turn there, we're going to be there in just a moment. I want to do something real quickly, make one final as I find my place. Sorry, guys. I'm an old man trying to figure out technology. Where'd you go? We're good. There we go. One of the things I wanted to cover with you real quickly, and just please give me the freedom to do this, and I apologize in advance, but so many of you guys have been asking about Caden, and I just want to, it's easier just to put it out there than just kind of keep answering this, because it's really tricky. A lot of you guys, many of you guys follow us on social media. We've been in New York City since Tuesday. We got back really late last night, so if I smell like sewer, we just brought New York with us, and I'm so sorry for everybody that's from New York, but Manhattan smells terrible. It no longer smells like sewer, it smells like weed, because it's just legal, so I have not been smoking weed all week. It's just secondhand, just all over me. But we've had, one of the reasons we did this series, Great Expectations, was because what our family's been going through with Caden, where he's been working his whole life for this dream of playing college basketball, and he's had all these weird opportunities, and the school that we thought had offered him and we thought was golden and ready to go because of the things you see on ESPN that you're like, nobody knows about this, transfer portals and extra years of eligibility. Because of those things, they ended up pulling what we thought Caden was going to have at a particular school, and all of a sudden we're like, what do we do? Or what does he do? And so he's had some offers at a lot of schools, smaller schools around the country. One of them was King's College in Manhattan. And so that's where we were this week. And it was just to go and figure out, is he going to go there, or is he going to just be a student at Palm Beach Atlantic in West Palm and try to walk on in that team? And so we went there, and they recruited him hard. They're like, what are you studying? He's like, I'm studying theology. What do you want to do when you grow up? He's like, I want to take my dad's job. I don't know if you guys know that, but he's trying to make me unemployed. So he's going to school to study Bible and theology because he wants to be the pastor when I retire. So all of that, I know, is shocking, right? It's like, I'm retiring in like 5 years, apparently. He's coming in and taking over. All of that happened. We went to King's College, and literally they've made the offer, all of this stuff, and my son's saying no to it, to follow what the Lord wants him to do at Palm Beach, mainly because New York City is not, he's a beach guy and a warm body guy and not a crowd guy, and he hated New York City. So for all of you guys that are wondering, the decision has been made. He's going to Palm Beach Atlantic to study Bible and theology down there, and so I'm really proud of him. So thank you, seriously, thank you for walking through that with us. It's been one heck of a ride, and just it's confusing. We don't know what God's doing. We have no clue what God is doing with all of this, but I'm proud of how he's handling it. And Joe Bellflower's going to play ball in Illinois. We got some athletes in this room. We could have quite the church softball team if we wanted to. And I'd be the guy with the temper that gets us kicked out of the league. That's what I would be. So I'd do great at that. John 14. We're going to read verses 15 through 17. On your guide, on the weekly, you're going to have a number of verses listed. I am just going to read verses 15 through 17. That's all I'm going to read. And this is Jesus talking to his disciples right before he's crucified. This is what it says. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper. You want to underline those two words are really what's key in this text. Another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. Now, here's what's going on, just to bring you up to speed. We're in week two of the first series of several series that we're going to do throughout the summer on the topic of the Holy Spirit, okay? A topic we've never preached about in this church, but we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit all summer long, and we're going to do it through several series. This particular series is about this text in John 14, where Jesus is handing the baton off to the Holy Spirit. So in John 14, he's talking to his disciples. He's telling them, listen, things are about to change. I'm about to go away. And they're freaking out. They're like, where are you going? I want to go with you. And he's like, you can't go with me. And how do we know where you're at? He's like, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And they're confused. They're like, I have no idea what's going on. And then he comes to them in John 14. He says, but don't worry. It's to your advantage that I go away. At which point, the disciples, just like you and me, would be like, what are you talking about? It's to our advantage that you go away. You're our cash cow. Our destinies, our futures are tied to you. Wherever you go, that's what we get. If you go away, we have nothing. Our entire legacy is attached to you. We're not going to have cabinet positions. Peter's not going to be the prime minister. It's like, what's going to happen if you go away? And Jesus says, it's to your advantage that I go away, because when I go away, I'm going to ask the Father to send you another helper. And what he's referring to, or who he's referring to here, is the person of the Holy Spirit. And what we spoke on last week, in week one of this series, was why is it an advantage if Jesus went away, if he ascended into heaven to sit at the right hand of the Father, why was it an advantage to have the Holy Spirit with us rather than Jesus Christ himself in the flesh? Because if we ask any Christian on the street, it'd be like, would you rather have Jesus Christ sitting with you in the flesh at lunch today, or just this Holy Spirit that you can't see, you can only kind of in faith believe is there? Which would you, and we're all like, yeah, I want the flesh. Bring Jesus on, right? But here's the thing. There are three advantages I think of. There's probably a lot more. When Jesus says it's an advantage for you that I go away and the Holy Spirit comes. Advantage number one was that the Holy Spirit's omnipresent. He can be everywhere at all times, all at once. So he can be here in this room. He can be in Sri Lanka. He can be in Durban, South Africa. He can be in Mexico City. He can be in Haines City. All at the same time, he's omnipresent. But Jesus, as a human, Jesus as man, could not be omnipresent. He couldn't be with Peter and Mark if they're in different cities. So he's saying to his disciples, it's better that I go away, because now God is going to reside in you, in the person of the Holy Spirit. At all times, everywhere you go, he is with you. The second advantage is that we now have an advocate. Two advocates, actually, is what we find out here. We have an advocate in heaven because Jesus is now ascending to the Father, where he will be our intercessor. We find this in Hebrews and in James. He's going to forever be our intercessor against our sin. He's going to remind the Father, listen, I paid the price for their sin. So Jesus is going away to be our advocate. And then the Holy Spirit is going to be our advocate here on earth. So we have two advocates, one fighting on our behalf in heaven, one fighting on our behalf here on earth. And then the third reason is it establishes faith. Our faith is built it builds and continues to build when we are trusting in the person, the work of the Holy Spirit residing in us. Now, here's the thing, and Renee, this is mercy here, okay? Here's the scary part. Her uncle is now the pastor of the church that I'm about to talk about, okay? And he's doing a great job. I check him out all the time. He has a southern voice, and he just really connects with the people. But Renee and I grew up in Pentecostal church, okay? We grew up in the denomination Church of God, okay? If you've heard of the Assemblies of God, Church of God is kind of its sister. We kind of grew up in those roles. Now, here's where I want to start. I want to find out who we are in this room. Please don't be ashamed. This is the beauty of non-denominational. We're all over the place. How many of you guys did not grow up in church at all? Be loud and proud for that, okay? So quite a few of you, probably 10% of you. How many of you guys are like Catholic or high church? You're welcome. Half of you are in. So we got Catholic high church in here, okay? How many of you guys are some kind of Reformed, Conservative, Lutheran, Methodist, Presbyterian church? And how many of my crazy charismatics are in the house? You're quiet. It's supposed to be, woo, right? Like giving me something in tongues or falling out or gold dust falling from the ceiling, something like that happening. That's what Renee and I grew up in. This is our world. This is our vibe. And here's the thing that I've been thinking about all week. When we were in New York, this is what I'm thinking about. Whatever culture, whether it's church or house environment, whatever schooling, whatever city, suburbia, or inner city, whatever we grew up in, we as young children believe that this is the standard. We believe what we know, our worldview, is how everybody else thinks, how everybody else sees things. So when we're in New York City, for example, the other day, we were walking from Central Park. We were over by the Guggenheim Museum, so the east side of Central Park. And we're just going to a deli, and we walk about half a mile to one of the most, they can do food in New York. That's one thing they can do. And so we're walking to this deli, and on the way, we walk by two elementary schools, private elementary schools. And I looked them up because I'm nosy. I immediately Googled. I wanted to find out how much tuition is in New York City elementary school. Ladies and gentlemen, $60,000 a year per student. And they were at recess. This is what you get for $60,000 a year per student. They were at recess and their playground. You know where their playground was? It was 70 feet of street that the cops blocked off, and the cops were watching them as they played on the street. $60,000, that's a good deal. Makes me want to live in New York City. I'm like, this, for $60,000, your kid too can play in the street. So it's a really good deal. And I'm thinking to myself, these kids, think about this, these kids think that's normal. They think their worldview forever is going to be, this is what kids do. Now, granted, they have one of the biggest parks in the world right next to them in Central Park. But during school, this is it. And they're thinking to themselves, this is what normal is. So I can't speak for Renee, but I can truly speak for myself that I was raised in this church till I was 19 years old, and I don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater, okay? In this church, I gave my life to Jesus. At 8 years old, I was baptized in the baptistry at that church. I fell in love with Jesus. I was called into ministry in this church. There are people there that are still dear to me. The lady that was our children's director when we were little, which was a long time ago, is still the children's director there today. This is an incredible church. But there were things about that church that scared me. And it was this part dealing with the Holy Spirit. It was this part because our denomination, the Church of God denomination, there's several Church of God denominations. One of them is Church of God of Prophecy. They take it to a whole new level, okay? They put the prophecy part in their name. There's Church of God out of Anderson, Indiana. We're Church of God out of Cleveland, Tennessee, which is where Duran is from. Pastor Duran's from that town. And several of us went to school there at Lee University in Cleveland, Tennessee. And so the thing about that denomination is they presented Jesus, they presented the Heavenly Father. I knew Jesus, I knew the scriptures, I could do sword drills, I learned about all of that. But the emphasis on the charismatic churches, like the Assemblies of God and the Church of God, and I'm not bashing them, I'm just saying this is just fact, is that their emphasis is on, not on the person and the work of the Holy Spirit, but the expressions of the Holy Spirit, okay? It's often on the gifts, the manifestations of the Holy Spirit. And as a kid, I didn't know what to do with that, okay? So they talked about tongues. They didn't even talk about tongues. They just did it. And it was never really explained. It wasn't, we didn't discover who the Holy Spirit was, what he was about. It was just, this is the Holy Spirit, and you're really spiritual if you do these things. I don't know if Renee remembers this, but our nighttime services is where it got wild, okay? So in the morning, it was a little safer, but at nighttime, this is where it got wild. The preachers would get a little bit more animated. Have you seen Duran when he gets animated? Jack that up about 10 times, okay? And this is what it was. And so we would get this, and what would happen, I'm trying to be careful. I'm really trying to be careful because I'm not throwing the bait. This church meant everything to me. There were just moments that scared me. And one of the things that would happen in some of these charismatic churches, and this isn't just the church we grew up in, this is churches we visited, this is a church I used to work at just down the street that I'm not naming. What would happen is if it was a good service, if it was a quote unquote good service, it was a service where the Holy Spirit took over. And those of you guys that are charismatic Pentecostal backgrounds, you know exactly what I mean. The Holy Spirit took over in a manner where worship happened. Elgin and the band are leading worship, and the Holy Spirit moved in such a way that the preacher didn't have to preach. Okay, so it got emotional. And that always struck as one that's like, I really enjoy the Word of God, and I'm connecting the dots. I'm like, didn't the Holy Spirit write the Word? Isn't he the voice of the Word? And so when the Holy Spirit moves, the Holy Spirit shuts himself up. Like, I couldn't connect the dots in that. And now, I get it. There are going to be moments where the Holy Spirit just messes up the order of service. And I don't ever want to discount that. I don't ever want to discount that. But throwing the Word out, okay? So things happen. Things happen. I watched my grandmother fall out in the Spirit one time when I'm like, Grandma, I didn't even know you knew Jesus. Like, and so all of these weird things, I see people jumping on pews. I saw one of the evangelists ran around the room. And I'm not saying anything. It was weird to me. So as a teenager, when I was going to big church at night, I volunteered to be the sound guy. I'm not a musician. I know nothing about what Zach does back there on the sound. I have no clue how to run a soundboard, but I knew it was the furthest thing from the altar, and they couldn't call me out, and I wouldn't have to be weird. So I'm back there. That's what I'm doing. And it hit me. It hit me as a young man. I'm like, this can't be. And again, this is on me. I'm not blaming my pastor. To this day, I love my pastor. He's still my pastor. But there was something missing. And as I went into Bible college, I went into the person, the work of the Holy Spirit class, and I'm like, tell me there's more to the Holy Spirit than just tongues. Because all we were taught was tongues, 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 tongues. If you're filled, if you're baptized with the Holy Spirit, you're going to speak in tongues. And the Holy Spirit has been reduced to this one element, which we will talk about later this summer. But nobody asked, who is he? What does he do? What's it all about? So here's what happened. As I got older and went to seminary, I intentionally went to a seminary that was polar opposite. I went to Reformed Theological Seminary in Oviedo. Any Reformed brothers and sisters in the house? You guys, you're scared to raise your hand because that you can't raise your hand in church. That's too loud, okay? So you don't know what to do with that. So I went to RTS, and at RTS, man, some of the world's greatest minds are there. John Frame is there. One of our guest speakers, guest lecturers was D.A. Carson. Really smart people, and they taught about Jesus. They taught about the Father. They talked about Bible history or the history of Christianity, biblical exegesis. I learned Greek. I learned Hebrew. Learned not one thing about the Holy Spirit. Not one thing. The faucet had been shut off on the Holy Spirit apparently when the disciples died. And so my childhood experience with the Holy Spirit was all experiential. Everything was experiential. But my adult education was no Holy Spirit at all. And as I walked out of seminary, I'm sitting there going, okay, maybe God has put me in a unique position. Maybe God is doing something behind the scenes in my life, similar to what he's done in Eric and Elizabeth by bringing Christian into their lives and doing all these different things and the things he's doing in your life, where he's uniquely wired me with an experience like that growing up and then an education like this where my Pentecostal friends said, don't go to this school. They will snuff out the life from me. You know what? It didn't snuff out the life from me. It added value. And so my ministry, and this is where we're going as a church. I believe our ministry as Orlando North is to marry spirit and truth. Jesus talks to the woman in the well in John chapter 4 and says, the time is coming when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. So one of the things that you're going to notice in the culture of Orlando North is we're doing a couple of things. We're trying to marry the ancient and the modern. Okay, so every week you're going to hear a hymn, Be Thou My Vision this morning. You're going to hear it. You're going to see, because of this building, we've maximized what we can do with this building. Stained glass, Apostles' Creed. The ancient meeting modern. We're going to merge the two. But most importantly, we're going to marry spirit and truth. Spirit and truth. So most churches, and this is not the way it's supposed to be. Most churches will make you pick. Do you want spirit, Holy Spirit, charismatic, or do you want truth, reformed movement, where it's just all intellectual discipleship, be a better citizen, which do you want? I'm like, yes, yes. I don't necessarily want just the experience of the Holy Spirit. I want the truth. I want the biblical Holy Spirit, and I want biblical truth. And my question to you this morning is, if your family is going through an absolute tragedy, If the rug has been swept out from you and you don't know what to do, which one of those two camps are you calling on? If you need a miracle, if you need God to move in a significant way, are you calling the charismatic or are you calling the reformed? Answer me. Help me. Trick question. Both. I want somebody who's going to believe in God, that he can do the impossible. But I also want somebody that's going to speak the truth into my situation. I want both. That's what I hope Orlando North becomes, that we're a church of spirit and truth. A guy that I want to be a friend, he doesn't know I exist. He's liked my tweets a couple times when I've responded to him. He has no clue who I am. His name's Josh Howerton. He's a pastor of Lake Point Church in Texas. He tweeted this after I'd already written this a couple weeks ago, and I'm like, man, why do you keep stealing my stuff? And look what he tweeted. I'm going to put the screenshots on here. He says, here's what charismatics are about. They're about breakthrough and power encounter. The Reformed tradition, they're about discipleship and process. Okay, so charismatics, breakthrough, power, Reformed, discipleship, and process. You better have a theology of both. Listen to this. You can't cast out the flesh and you can't disciple a demon. That's so good. Why can't I think like that? That's people like that write books. That's really good, okay? So you can't cast out the flesh and you can't disciple a demon. Then he continued, we will get real stuck if we're praying for deliverance when what is needed is discipleship and vice versa, okay? So I think this pretty much nails it on the head. Charismatics are so focused on expressions and gifts of the Holy Spirit that they often throw the baby out with the bathwater. There's no discipleship and there's no process and there's no maturing. At least that's the stereotype. Now, granted, everybody... Okay, if you grew up at Calvary or Wakiva or Jefferson Avenue Church of God in Midland, Michigan, there's certainly exceptions, okay? But this is what the charismatics are known for. And it's all about emotional experience and believing that the Holy Spirit can do the miraculous. And for those of you of a more reformed conservative tradition, so much of it is on the intellectual side of things that discipleship doesn't involve any relationship or expression of the Holy Spirit. And I believe that both are a mistake. I believe that both are a mistake. So I want both for our church. So that brings us to this question, who is the Holy Spirit? Who is he? Who is he? Next week, we're going to start diving into what does the Holy Spirit do. But today, we're going to talk about who he is. Last week, we talked about him being a he. We started with this. And this is all I want you to walk away from with today. And so if you don't remember anything, remember this. The Holy Spirit is personal. The Holy Spirit is personal and desires a relationship with you, as does Jesus. The reason I say that is because when we think of the Holy Spirit, whether we're charismatic or we're Reformed or we're Catholics going, what in the world did I walk into this morning? This is crazy, okay? Honestly, Catholics, you guys give more attention to the Holy Spirit than anybody, right? You really do. And so in this, the question or the statement of all of this is that we have a personal relationship with the Holy Spirit. Here's the way we treat the Holy Spirit, everybody, no matter what side of the spectrum spiritually you are on. We treat the Holy Spirit as a magical force, okay? Those of us that are children of the 70s and 80s, you know what we've done with the Holy Spirit, right? We've Luke Skywalkered him. We have. I'm not even, the more I thought about it, I'm like, we literally believe the Holy Spirit is the force. Think it's the Empire Strikes Back, right? Empire Strikes Back where Luke is in the pit with Yoda, right? And he's learning the force. He's upside down and he's got to empty himself of all thought and all consciousness. And he's got to move that rock. And he doesn't realize at this point that Yoda is Yoda. And so he's tapping into the force. If I can tap into the force, I can move the rock. I can have the power and I can do this thing. And I don't know how many services I've sat through where it's all about whipping up, emptying myself of my thought, whipping up the emotion and the power to be able to do the impossible. Which is why I keep pointing us back to what true faith is. Faith is not believing that the impossible can become possible. Faith is believing in the one who has the capacity to make the impossible possible. My focus is on God, not on the miracle, okay? So this is what's going on. We're treating him like Luke Skywalker. Now, here's the thing. He's personal. He's not a force. We know this biblically because of three reasons. Number one, the Holy Spirit can be grieved. He can be saddened. We find this in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God by whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. So when we screw up, when we kind of reject Jesus, the Holy Spirit's heart is broken. A force isn't grieved. Secondly, he can be outraged and insulted. Hebrews 10 says this, how much worse punishment do you think will be deserved by the one who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and has profaned the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and has outraged the Spirit of grace. So he's got emotion to him. A force doesn't have emotion. A force is emotionless. And finally, the Holy Spirit loves. Romans 15, 30. I appeal to you, brothers, by our Lord Jesus Christ and by the love of the Spirit. Okay, so again, may the force be with you. Man, 3 days from now, right? We could have done it on Star Wars Day, May the 4th. And so in this, the Holy Spirit isn't a force. He's not this cosmic robot. He's personal. He's personal. And the main thing I want to point out, he is not an it. Not an it. I'm going to play a video for you, a very short video by one of my favorite bands of all times, the Gaithers. Come on, everybody over 40, you're loud and proud. You're like, yeah, Bill and Gloria are kind of my jams. Okay, everybody else that doesn't know, go to Spotify, and you're gonna think I'm crazy. But I love to get my parents had all their videos, the VHS tapes. My favorite song of all times is "Because He Lives," which is Bill and Gloria Gaither. When I was a kid, I am a promise with a capital P. I am a promise. I am what God made me to be. Okay, so this is the Gaithers. They got one wrong. Here it is. Check this out. Cut and scene. How many of you guys sang that song in choir? You sang that song in church? I'm like, that's the jams right there, right? How many of you guys right now can say there's something wrong with that song? Doctrinally, there's two things wrong with that song. Number one, send it on down. He is not an it. So they're literally praying for a force to come down. Second of all, the Holy Spirit, as we've already talked about, is omnipresent. He's already here. He's living and residing in us. There's no need for him to come down. He's here. okay? So as Elgin and our band sang this, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. It's an acknowledgement of his presence that is already with us. It's welcoming him into the heart, the home of our hearts, rather than saying, hey, send this force down, send this force down, send this force down. Now, in this text, it's really important that we understand, I'm getting close to wrapping up. In John 14, Jesus says this. He says, I will ask the Father, he will give you another helper. Now, helper, we're going to talk about this in extent, big time next week. Helper is the Greek word, which we talked about last week, the Greek word paraclete, which means helper, counselor, comforter, advocate. Okay, it means these four things. Today, I don't want to focus on that word, paraclete. I want to focus on the word another. Why would Jesus say, I'm going to send another helper, comforter, counselor, advocate? Why another? And what he's implying here is, I am your helper, comforter, advocate, and I'm going away, and I'm going to be those things to the Father, but I'm going to send one to be here on earth. I'm not sending an it. I'm not sending a dusty cloud of force. I'm sending someone personal to be your comforter, counselor, advocate, here, helper here on planet Earth. But the word another, this is really interesting. In Greek, there are two words used for another, two different words that are used for another. The first Greek word is the word heteros, which we know this word. This is a word we use in English, heterosexual. Heteros means two different things, an apple and an orange, okay? So heterosexual, boy and girl, okay? I'm not even going to go there. Everybody's worried or wants me to go, I'm not going there. Apple and orange, two different things. That's heteros. That is not what's being used in this text. The other Greek word for another is the word allos, A-L-L-O-S, which means two different things from the same kind. So heteros is an apple and an orange. Allos is a Macintosh apple and a Granny Smith apple. Two different things of the same kind. Want to guess which one Jesus is using here when he says, I'm going to send you another helper. He's using the word allos. We're of the same. We're three in one Trinity, different roles, different function, different person. And this is what he's saying in this. And this person, this one, is just like me. We come from the same, we're both personal. We both have a relationship. Don't treat me like a force and don't treat him like a force. Now think of this. In Eastern religion, their philosophy and their view of getting close to God is to empty oneself. Think about the meditation that those of you guys that grew up in really conservative homes, your parents are like, don't do yoga. And then I remember when I got P90X, I'm like, there's a yoga video in here. What am I, my mom's gonna kill me if I do yoga. Like you sit around and you hum and you chant and you do this and you do, like, I can't do yoga. Eastern philosophy, Eastern religion's view of how to get close to God is to have meditation. And in that meditation, what do? You empty yourself. The closer you are to God, the way to connect with God is to empty yourself of all thought, all emotion, just be non. And as you are non, you are drawing closer to God. That's Luke Skywalker stuff right there, right? Like empty yourself and that rock will move and you will be governed by the force. So that's Eastern religion. That's Eastern philosophy. It is that biblical meditation. So much so that when we hear David say that I will meditate on something, we're like, whoa, he said meditate. Mom, what do I do with that? Like the Hebrew can't mean meditate, right? No, it's different. Biblical meditation doesn't empty ourselves of thought and say, okay, force, come in. Biblical meditation fills ourselves with thought of the word. I will meditate on the law, your word, day and night. So I will fill myself with the Spirit. I will think about the law that he wrote. I will think about his words, and the Spirit of God will fill me rather than empty me so a force can rush through me. I'm not becoming some kind of haruga guy, right? It wouldn't be so funny if there weren't televangelists that do this. People won't listen to normal preachers because of the crazy ones. And that stuff is bogus. Empty yourself so you can be filled with the force and Hizinga it all out, okay? Whatever. No, the word, you're supposed to meditate and chew and regurgitate on the word of God. Let the Spirit of God fill you. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. And the promise of being filled with the Holy Spirit is that you will have power and joy. And man, that's what I want for us. That's what I want for us. Let me give you a last example. Band, you guys can come on up. When Renee and I were little, I can't believe Renee's here today. I cannot believe she's here. During worship, all I could think about is Renee is here. Oh, my Lord. And Lee knows our church well. Lee went to our church for a long time. We had this thing called Kids Crusade when I was a kid. It was the highlight of my childhood, man. It was the best. I think we did VBS, Vacation Bible School, once in a while, but we did Kids Crusade often. And Kids Crusade was where we brought... We always brought back these two ladies. To this day, I don't even know what their names are, but we had these. I think one of them's name was Pat, and I think Renee was too young. But these two would come, and during the summer, they would do these services at nighttime just for kids, and we were encouraged to bring our friends. And there would be contests, boys versus girls, who can give the most offering. Little did I know, we were paying their salaries through our child offering. And so we were doing these offerings. They would do puppet shows, games, they would present the gospel. I still remember some of the lessons I learned during those days. There are things in your childhood that really stick. And so those of you guys that work in children's ministry, first of all, it's worth it. Second of all, thank you. Thank you. Like, literally, I love Jesus today because of people like you. I really, really do. And so these guys would come and they would do this thing, they would do this shtick, and it was just awesome. They present the gospel, kids would give their lives to Christ. It was powerful. We had so many kids, even when our church was small, we had so many kids show up for Kids Crusade. And one year, I think it was the second year, Pat and whatever the other lady's name was, I found out that my parents had invited them to their house for dinner. That's back in the day when you didn't go out to dinner, you invited people into your home. And so they invited us, my parents invited them into our home, and they were gonna come over for dinner after Kids Crusade. And I remember that day, it was a summer day, and so I'm supposed to be playing, but I did not spend that day playing. Instead, my brother and I spent the day cleaning the house. We cleaned everything. We cleaned the kitchen. We cleaned the bathrooms. We cleaned the living room. We dusted. We mopped. We did everything. We cleaned our bedrooms. We cleaned rooms that they weren't going to see. We cleaned everything because these guests were coming. And the interesting thing about all of this is that when our guests arrived, when Pat and the other lady arrived, my brother and I were on our best behavior, and it wasn't a show. Now, you got to understand this about me and my brother. We fought all the time. Not some of the time, all the time. He'd instigate me, and I'd hurt him, and I'd get in trouble. That's just the little brother, big brother way it goes. And so we fought all the time. But that day, we were on our best behavior, and it wasn't a show. The awareness, listen to this, the awareness of our guest presence changed our behavior. My brother and I didn't fight. We were buddies. We were on the same page. We were unified by the presence of our special guest. It was an honor to be in their presence, and we recognized it. The point is, the little things that my brother and I always fought about that we thought were really big deals, all of a sudden didn't matter in the presence of our guest. The guest changed everything. Our guests were here, and we hung on their presence. We hung on their words more than we did our petty disagreements. We were filled with their presence. How well is the church doing in culture with each other, with the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives, when we're fighting and we're fighting about things that, yeah, they matter, but in the presence of a holy God who fills us and lives with us and is omnipresent with us and changes everything, we're like, hey, you're stupid, you're stupid, you're stupid. Where in that is our guest honored? So before we can go into all of the depth of what the Holy Spirit does and the things that a lot of you guys are like, oh my gosh, what's he gonna do when we get to this subject or this subject? Can we for a minute pause and be like, he's not freaky. We've made him out to be freaky. We've made him out to be this force, this weird force. Instead, he's the one that lives and resides in us and speaks the words of the Father to our hearts. He's our advocate. He's our peacemaker. And if we could all realize and recognize that, Holy Spirit, you live and dwell and reside in us, maybe our petty differences wouldn't matter anymore. So my prayer for us is that we're a church of the Spirit and of truth. Don't get freaked out thinking I'm throwing this thing away. That ain't happening. We're going to find the marriage between the two, but it begins by understanding he's not a force, he's a person. And he wants a personal relationship with you. Every single day, you can talk to the Spirit of God who's living and residing in you. He's your comforter, he's your friend, he's your advocate, but he is not a force for you to just do whatever you want with. This is who he is, and it's such an honor to have him living in our lives. Would you stand with me this morning? Every week, we're just going to chisel away a little bit more at this every week so that the Holy Spirit, by the end of this, we're not only not afraid of him, we're like, Holy Spirit, in my heart, be everything that you are. I've blocked you. I've made you out to be something that you're not. And I want all of you. I want everything that you have for me. I want the fruit. I want the gifts. I want the presence. I want all of it. Holy Spirit, this morning, on behalf of Christ Church, I personally repent for the way I've treated you and handled you as though you were created for my glory and not your own. Jesus, thank you for sending your helper, your advocate, to help us walk through this crazy life where it's so difficult and it's so challenging. And without you, it'd be impossible. But you're here, you're with us, you're in us. And so today, we acknowledge that. We recognize who you are. Holy Spirit, we want a relationship with you. I pray that you would give us the courage and the boldness to really focus on you this week, to meditate on the word that you inspired, and to allow it to change us, change our thinking. No matter what side of the religious spectrum we fall on or came from, help us to find the truth. Help us to walk in the truth. Because that's where you're at. May we be worshipers who worship the Father in spirit and in truth. It's in your name we pray.